Portugal Basher. And we're in Trinidad and Tobago for Carnival 2020. It's been a blast. We've been everywhere. We went to all the fairs and we just had a wonderful time. But you know what my fondest memory is? The time I spent with classical musician Marsman and a man who I'm now honored to call a friend, the legendary Etienne Charles. I spent some time following Etienne and really just documenting his vibe for Carnival 2020. And let me tell you something, I am so impressed. Etienne has really resurrected my childhood memories of what Carnival was like and what it's meant to be and where the foundation came from. I just love Etienne and I know you'll fall in love with him too. Just his vibe, his style, his passion for music and what he's doing to keep the culture alive. Not just by himself, but by collaborating with others like Kes, Brother, Baron, and everyone. So take a look at this young genius by the name of Etienne Charles.
My name is Etienne Charles and I'm a musician. The first person that inspired me to be connected to music was my mother. When I was a baby, she would play records at home every day when she got home from work. She never liked the house to be quiet, and so the record player was always on whenever she was home. Naturally, I had a connection with music for a long time because of that, but also it's genetic. My father played the steel band, my grandfather played the quattro and guitar and sang. Many of my uncles play guitar and quattro, and then on my mom's side, both of her grandfathers were musicians.
Did anyone try to talk you out of your dream to be a musician?
Oh, they're still talking me out of it, you know, because you know, we live in a place, we live in a region where people are told that there are only certain vocations that are quote unquote respectable or sustainable, certain professions that are more lucrative than others. And so yeah, when I was about 12 or 13, when I really was inclined toward going to music, people were like, yeah, you know, you'll never make any money, you know, you won't be able to have a family life, you know, blah, 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 you get hooked on drugs, so many musicians this, so many musicians that. And you know, somebody told me, you know, don't let somebody put their fears on you. And someone else told me, if someone has not walked a road, you should not take directions from them. Listen, I went to school to study music, and then I did my master's at Juilliard, and then from there, it, you know, one thing led to the other, but really it was a drive, you know, that drawing towards trying to mimic the sound of my mom's voice.
You have such a unique style. What inspires this style that has come to be known as the Etienne Charles swag?
I mean, comfort first and comfort last. You know, there should be nothing else but comfort in fashion. And for me, fashion is 100% based on where I am and what I'm feeling. So I dress based on the weather. We're here 11 degrees north of the equator, so I have no sleeves, I have shorts. But I'm also heavily influenced by my idols. You know, I'm a jazz musician, and I'm also a musician heavily influenced by, I'm a Trinidadian musician, I'm a Caribbean musician. And so, you know, naturally, for me, a straw hat in summer and in hot weather, and a felt hat in winter and in cold environments is natural for me, because it's a part of the tradition of not just calypso, but jazz, also Brazilian music, many of the black cultures of the Americas. When you look at old pictures of the different performers, suit and hat, you know, that was kind of the standard. And so I'm very driven towards maintaining traditions while expanding on them. And so, you know, and I'm also based on my clothes, based on where I've been. You know, I love telling stories. So like this necklace I'm wearing, I got in Togo in a market from a lady who's from the Niger Delta.
Wow.
Made of clay. It's actually a really heavy necklace. I made one into an anklet. I love wearing anklets because it just grounds me a little bit to remind me that my ancestors had no choice but to put them on their ankle. Always have things on my wrist just as a reminder of where we've been and what we've been through. And that also drives my fashions, you know, because it's about expression. It's a way to speak to people who might not speak your language. And it's what I mean as a teacher. I'm all about expanding on the ideas. So for my students are always asking me, like, how did you put this together? Why did you do this? Why did you do that? And so I try to maintain all the traditions. And because the dandy tradition, the black fashion tradition, the, you know, many of the traditions that influenced Europe and influenced European fashion all come from here in the Caribbean. The original dandies were all black freed slaves from the Caribbean.
You talked about your idols. Who would you say are your idols in music?
I have too many.
Okay.
You know, we'll be here all day, but some of the names that come to mind early on, specifically here in Trinidad, people like Lionel Belasco, Lord Kitchener, Mighty Sparrow for his singing and his way of performing. People like Winsford Devine, who's a great songwriter. He still is a great calypsonian and songwriter. Arrangers like Ron Berridge, Rupert Nurse, musicians like Fitzroy Coleman, Clarence Curver and Roy Cape, people who were in the industry here in Trinidad, and you go around the Caribbean, like Shay Keane from St. Vincent, who was an unbelievable trumpet player, and then also people like Louis Armstrong, who really was the world's first pop star. Clifford Brown, Dizzy Gillespie, my mentors, Ralph McDonald, Monty Alexander, Marcus Roberts, Winter Marsalis, the list is really long, Nicholas Payton, Bob Marley, the list is ridiculous. Johann Sebastian Bach, all these people who use their art to transcend the world, really, like, I love listening to David Rudder sing, I love listening to Byron's voice, and knowing that Lester Paul did all of those arrangements, and so Lester Paul is a big hero of mine, Pelham Goddard is a big hero of mine, and they know the song, and they know the singer, they know the artist, but the concept of the arrangement, the architect of the music, is not really familiar. So those are some of my many: John Coltrane, Charlie Parker, Cannonball Adderley, Nancy Wilson, Mary Lou Williams. The list is really, really, really long.
And these days, you're somewhat of a masked man, but your band is unique. Tell us about the Etienne Charles Monday Masked Band, because we've been hearing about a lot of good stuff.
So the idea came from me on my first trip back to Trinidad for Carnival in many, many years. And I was doing a research project in the Savannah on a Carnival Tuesday, and I looked around for the whole day and did not see one live brass band anywhere.
Yeah.
And when I was growing up, there were brass bands everywhere. So I decided that I needed to put a brass band on. So with that in mind, what I did was I took the band and I assembled some musicians, and we said we're coming out on the road to play live. Called up David Rudder, called up all of these great players. And I announced it at the concert I was doing, the world premiere of my Carnival project. Announced the band, and there was an uproar. There was an uproar.
What's up with you and Kes, the band?
So, Kes and I have actually been connected since we were eggs.
Really?
Because our moms were in class at the St. Joseph's Convent.
Wow.
Oh, decades ago.
Yes.
His mom was is still a great singer, Donna Pruden, at the time, now Donna Dollar. And our mothers were in class together. And so when we met in, I think, 1996 or 7. During a production that he was singing in, and he was also painting the set. Each other gigs and festivals, and then, you know, our careers went separate ways and connected. We reconnected. I would always run into him on the road. He was on tour, I was on tour. And then in 2014, I was in Trinidad, and I went to the bar, and Kes was doing his first set of promos for his Tuesday on the Box.
I got the opportunity to see you jamming at rehearsals with Baron and Rodney, and man, it blew my mind. It took me back to my childhood, and my respect grew like 1,000%, because then I saw you, you're not just a musician, you write music, you know music, you tweak music. And for a moment I felt sad whilst feeling like I was in the company of such greatness. But I felt sad and grateful to people like you for wanting to continue this outstanding tradition. Without you all, there'll be no music.
until you see Lester Paul playing a keyboard.
Yeah.
Until you see Rodney Alexander playing the bass. Until you see Tony Paul playing a saxophone. Until you see Shaka Charles playing trumpet. Until you see Byron holding a microphone and singing. And your dad or mom saying, that man is a legend.
That's what we always had, right? And now Mardi Gras, they're doing that. Yeah, jamming to live music.
Yeah,
when it started in Caribbean.
Yeah, they've had, I mean, that whole tradition of live music and carnival has always been essential. It's the way that the procession gets driven.